Well, it's 4 o'clock. Lovely to see so many smiley faces. And if you are new, a very, very warm welcome to you today. I hope you received a warm welcome at the door, and please do join us afterwards for refreshments just through the door and round to the left. We'd love to talk to you and meet you. We do have a special guest. His name is Sam, and Sam will introduce Sam later in the service. Sam Aubrey will be coming to bring God's word to us later in the service. But before we begin, let's just quieten ourselves and commit this afternoon to the Lord. O Lord God, in a week tinged with sadness, with the loss of our dear sister Frances, we remember the exhortation to rejoice in the Lord always. So Lord, we ask that you will inhabit our praises, you'll listen and answer our prayers, and you'll inspire by your Holy Spirit the word brought by Sam this afternoon. We ask that we would meet with you, an amazing, awesome God, and be changed by being in your presence this afternoon. And we ask this through your precious Son. Amen. So let's turn to our sheets, and everything you need for the service is on the sheet. And let's start by recognizing how amazing our God is. If you could respond to that which I say by repeating the words in bold at the top of the sheet. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. So let's join together and praise our amazing God.
Our God, sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander, and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees, when I look down on lofty mountain grandeur, and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul,
our sins, and we're promised that God is faithful and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness if we confess those sins. So join me. Heavenly Father, you love us so much, you gave us Jesus.
We're sorry for loving other things more.
Lord Jesus, you love us so much, you died on the cross to save us from our sins.
We're sorry for living for ourselves
and forgetting that we belong to you. Mighty God, you pour your love into our hearts through the Holy Spirit.
We're sorry for trying to live for you in our own strength.
Help us to depend on
your Holy Spirit.
Amen. Please take a seat, and I think Peter is going to come and lead us. Oh, sorry.
I'm sorry, I'm just going to hijack this a little bit. I've got a few things which I'd love to share with us all as a church family before I hand over to Peter for our family focus. So you'll be aware, as Ruth has already mentioned, that very sadly this week, Francis Williams, our dear friend and sister in the Lord, went to be with the Lord. There's a wonderful verse in 2 Timothy that said, where the Apostle Paul says, I've run the race and I have fought the good fight, and there is now in store for me the crown of righteousness. And our dear sister, she's finished the race and she's now with the Lord. We grieve, but we grieve not as those without hope. We have a wonderful hope. And this is just to flag up the celebration service for her life, which will be on a week on Tuesday. And I know it might need a bit of logistical stuff for us, but if you can make the logistics work, it would be lovely to have as many from the church family there to celebrate her life as possible. So that's a bit of advance notice for that one. A reminder that our marriage course starts next Monday. We're having an introductory evening. Do come along. If you're like, yes, I meant to sign up for that, I haven't yet, don't worry, it's not too late. You can still sign up and you can still invite others as well. We've got a nice little group, but there's space for more. So that's a reminder about that. And then just the final thing from me is our kids' tea, which happens after the service every week. And just a plea to, if we can clear our tables after we finish with the kids, that's going to really help our refreshments team so they can focus their efforts in the kitchen. And if we can take responsibility for making the hall, sure the hall is as clear as it can be, they're going to be kind of spray bottles and cloths and the rest of it. So it should be nice and easy for those of us who are helping our kids with their tea to do that. That's all for me. I'm just going to pray. It'd be lovely to pray, especially for the memorial service of Francis and for her family. And then I'm going to hand over to Peter. Father, we do thank you for the life of Francis, the joy of fellowship with her for over these last years. And we pray for her family at the moment as they grieve her loss, and also for us as a church family as we adjust to this sad news ourselves. And thank you that there's great hope for her in our Lord Jesus, and pray that as we contemplate her life and death, that would only strengthen our confidence and hope in Jesus ourselves. And we thank you so much for him. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much. Over to Peter for our family favourites.
Brilliant. So, a couple of weeks ago, it was the great big Henley Green Week, wasn't it? Did anyone do anything special for it at school? Maybe do a few things at school? Did we see the things up in town? I'm sure you do. Maybe you can't remember back that far. But it was the great big Henley Green Week. And we're going to be thinking about, over the next 3 weeks, how following Jesus should help us think about how we care about the world and what a wonderful world it is. And the big thing is, God cares about the world, so we should care about the world. You got that? One simple message. God cares about the world, so we should care about the world. And one massive reason that God cares about the world is that he made the world. You know, the first words in the whole Bible are these: in the beginning, God created, just another word for made, God created the heavens and the earth. So that means that God made absolutely everything. Not just the world, but the whole universe. The massive things. Think of the biggest thing you possibly can. God made that. Think of the smallest thing you possibly can. Think of the smallest thing you possibly can. Maybe you need a microscope to see it. God made that too. God made absolutely everything in the whole world. And does anyone know what God said when he seen the world and seen how he'd made it? How did he describe it? Can anyone remember from thinking about it in the start of the Bible? Good. Exactly. Five times, 5 days. Good, 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 good. And on the last day, after he made human beings, it was very good. So God cares about the world, because God made the world. Now, hands up if you like making stuff, doing art at school, making things. Lots of hands. I know lots of you do. I can see lots of your lovely colouring in lanterns and torches. And you know, when we make something and it's really good, we want people to look after it, don't we? Now, I'm not very good at drawing, but I had a go at doing my drawing. I think this is some of my best work. You know, it's got a tree and a hill, and there's some sheep and there's some boats. For me, I was pretty pleased. Now, if I give that picture to Amelie to look after for me, do you look after that for me? I would be quite sad if Amelie just tore that picture up and put it in the bin. That made me very sad. You're not going to do that, are you, Amelie? No, good. That was the right answer. Well done. Otherwise, I'd be very sad. You don't want me very sad. But the thing is, we care about our pictures and our bits of art. And they're good, but they're not as good as the whole world that God's made, are they? As we think, if we care about our artwork, how much more do you think God cares about the whole world? Remember, God cares about the world because God made the world. And you know what that means? That we should be like, Emily's going to be with that picture, taking good care of it. We should look after our world because God made it. Do you know, when we try and do all those good things that we know to look after our environment, we do our recycling so the trees don't get cut down. We try and use our plastics less so that our oceans don't get as messed up. You know, we can remember we're doing these good things, not just because they're good things to do, but because when we're doing those, we're caring about the good, very good world that God made for us to enjoy. So let's remember, God cares about the world, so we should care about the world. And why does God care about the world? Because God made the world. And that's good news. And Sam's going to help us think more about that next week. But the amazing thing, the God who made the whole world is also the God who speaks to us in the Bible. And we're going to sing about that now. So do stand up. It's got actions. So follow me for the actions and follow musicians for the singing.
Thank you, Peter. Yeah, hope you can hear me now. It's time for our children to leave for their groups, and perhaps the leaders will come up, and then we'll quickly pray for the children before they go. So, Sparks.
Gemma is leading Sparks. She just had to shoot out at the moment. She'll be leading Sparks, which are for noughts to threes, and they are round. Back in that far corner, but follow the route round and there'll be people pointing you in the right direction.
Handles.
Hi there, Sean and I are going to be leading candles today. We're in the Morris room, so just go around there, take a right, and you'll see us there.
Lanterns.
Lanterns is reception to year two. I'm Duncan, and myself and Peter will be leading that group just literally at the end of the concourse.
Torches.
So for years, 3 to year 6, James and I will be leading torches. We are through in the pither hall, which is just out that hall, just out that door there, and through to your right.
I'm in. I'm there already. Yeah, I just moved that right up.
Thank you.
I'm Jamie, and we're doing Beacons. We're going to be in the chapel. That's years 7 to 9. So we're going to have lots of fun there. So follow me. If you don't know where it is, I'm easy to spot.
And as the children go out, let's just bow our heads in prayer for them and for their leaders. Heavenly Father, you call the little children unto you. You love them. You want to bless them. You want to see them grow in their walk by your side. And so, Lord, we just pray for the leaders, that they may inspire the children and teach them something that they can go away with this week. Lord, open the hearts of the children to receive that. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen. And I think Sally is.
Okay, so just whilst the kids are getting settled, and before we have our reading, I thought it'd be good just to get to know Sam a little bit. So, Sam, where have you come from to be with us today?
Good afternoon, everyone. Lovely to be with you. I've come from just across in Maidenhead. So I knew Sam when we were both on staff at St Mary's, so nearly 10 years ago now. So if you want some stories about Sam from the past, come and find me afterwards.
I think on aggregate, I've lost more hair than Sam in the preceding 10 years, but there we go. And Sam, give us just a little flavour of what you spend to kind of tend to spend your time doing.
Thank you. I'm a pastor. I'm sort of between things at the moment. I'm waiting for a visa to join the staff of a church in Nashville. And though I don't like country music, before you ask me that, but I suspect I may be forced to. So yeah, that's normally doing this kind of thing is what I get to do.
Now, it is the Henley Literary Festival. By the way, can I just say, isn't it great to have the word literary misspelt on the screen? But it's not as literary as you might think. But anyway, it is the Henley Literary Festival this week. And Sam, you are a writer as well. So tell us what you enjoy about writing and perhaps tell us what you've enjoyed writing about recently.
Yeah, I do enjoy writing. I have to think about that for a moment. I'm not very creative in other ways, so it's one way that I can be a little bit creative. And writing something helps me think about it. I used to think that you do the thinking and then you write it down, but I found actually the process of trying to write something really helps me understand it better. So even if no one else reads anything I've written, it's helped me.
And give us a highlight of something you've written recently that you're excited about.
Yeah, so just this summer I had a book come out, which is about what the Bible says about our bodies. Not a topic we maybe think much about, but the Bible has a lot to say. And the book is really just trying to show how Jesus is good news for our bodies. So I got excited about that. Yeah.
Okay, I can highly recommend anything that Sam's written. I've read just about everything apart from the book on the bodies, which Sam kindly gave me a few weeks ago, but I've not had time to start it yet. But highly recommended anything that Sam writes. And why don't I just pray now? We're going to turn to the book above all books, God's Word, and we're going to be praying for Sam that he can speak faithfully from God's Word to us now, just before Sally then comes to read. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for Sam. Thank you that he is here with us today. Thank you above all, though, for our Lord Jesus. And thank you that your word bears perfect testimony to him. And so we pray now as we turn to that word that you would open our hearts wherever we are on our journey with you. We pray that you would move us further on with you today. And we pray that for Jesus' sake. Amen.
The Old Testament reading is taken from Isaiah chapter 52, beginning at verse 13 and going on through to chapter 53, verse 6. It's on page 740 in the NIV Bibles. And it's the suffering and glory of the servant. See, my servant will act wisely. He will be raised and lifted up and highly exalted. Just as there were many who were appalled at him, his appearance was so disfigured beyond that of any human being, and his form marred beyond human likeness. So he will sprinkle many nations, and kings will shut their mouths because of him. For what they were not told, they will see, and what they have not heard, they will understand. Who has believed our message, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him like a tender shoot, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by mankind, a man of suffering and familiar with pain. Like one from whom people hide their faces, he was despised, and we held him in low esteem. Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering, yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. And the second reading is in the New Testament. It's taken from Colossians chapter 1, verses 15 to 23, which is page 1182 in the NIV Bibles. The supremacy of the Son of God. The Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities. All things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. Once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior. But now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation. If you continue in your faith, established and firm, and do not move from the hope held out in the gospel. This is the gospel that you heard, and that has been proclaimed to every creature under heaven, of which I, Paul, have become a servant. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you for reading God's word to us. Do keep your Bibles open in Colossians chapter 1. In my family, Uncle Nigel is a bit of an institution. He's not technically an uncle. I think he's my dad's cousin or second cousin. I have no idea what that makes him to me, but he's part of the branch of our family that's found its way to Australia. And he's taken it upon himself to try to trace our family tree. So every couple of years or so, he would come over, dig around a bit, unearth a few other relatives we didn't know we were descended from. And he kind of updates the thing every now and then and sends us a new one. And we kind of roll our eyes at how nerdy he gets over doing that. We're all a bit disappointed at how uninteresting our family tree is. No royalty or pirates yet to find in the lineage. But we're kind of glad he's doing it. It's kind of nice to know. It does mean something. You see these names written on a piece of paper and you think, okay, he's got us back to, I think, the early 1700s now. But it's telling us our family story. And it just does us good to know that. And that is what Paul is doing in the passage we're going to be thinking about this afternoon. Colossians 1, 21 to 23. He's telling the church, he's telling us our family story. And if you were here last week, you will know that Paul has been giving us an amazing vision of who Jesus is. This previous paragraph, verses 15 to 20, says some of the most significant and mind-blowing things about Jesus that are written anywhere in the Bible. And we need to keep coming back to them. I had some family staying recently and had sufficient number of guests that I had to bring out the old air mattress. And figured, given I was the youngest of the family who were here, that I should take the bullet and be the one to sleep on the air mattress. And suddenly realized what I had been inflicting on guests over the past few years. Inflated this thing to the point where it looked like it was about to burst. Got myself all kind of comfortable on it. And then at about 2 a.m. and then at about 4:30 a.m., when I realized I could feel the carpet under my back, I had to sort of keep topping this thing up and reinflating. I had no idea it was that uncomfortable. So I've repented of ever making anyone else sleep on that. Our view of Jesus does the same thing. We can get our minds kind of clear about who Jesus is, but over time, automatically, our view of Jesus just diminishes. It deflates, if you like. And so a passage like Colossians 1, 15 to 20 is there just to keep reminding us of just how full Jesus is. So I don't know about you, but I was looking at Colossians 1, getting ready for this afternoon, looking at the previous week's passage. And one of the things I'm going to try doing, and I don't know if this would help the rest of us, is every few weeks, every month or so, I'm going to try to remind myself to reread Colossians 1, 15 to 20, because I know my view of Jesus is going to keep subconsciously shrinking. So this is the real Jesus in whose name we meet this afternoon. If you think you are doing Jesus a favor by coming to church or by being a Christian, your view of Jesus has shrunk. If you think living for Jesus is a chore, it's just a hassle, then your view of Jesus has shrunk. If you think Jesus is in any way impressed by you, your view of Jesus has shrunk. Jesus is always bigger than we think he is, and he's always more beautiful than we think he is. It's actually really good news to us that Jesus is as big as Paul says he is. Because here's the thing, in Colossians 1, 15 to 20, and in our passage this afternoon, Jesus is not too great to notice you. We might think that in 15 to 20, he's cosmic, he's universal, there's, you know, it's mind-blowing. He's not too great to notice you. He's too great not to notice you. Which is why verse 21 comes after verse 20. Paul has shown us Jesus' relationship to all of reality, to the universe, to creation. And he can then drop in verse 21 down to a very personal note and say, once you were alienated from God. The Jesus who rules the universe, the Jesus that Paul says is supreme over everything, is the Jesus who can know you personally, the Jesus who can intervene in your life and in my life, the Jesus who knows us more thoroughly than we know ourselves, the Jesus who loves us even more than we love ourselves. And so that the Christ of 15 to 20 is also the Christ of verses 21 to 23. The one who is universal is also personal. And so Paul is going to tell us our story as it relates to this amazing Jesus. So three things for us in verses 21 to 23. What we once were, what we now are, and what we shall be. We're used to having Christians share their story of how they came to know Jesus. We often call it someone's testimony. We're used to hearing someone give their testimony. Well, Paul is giving us our testimony. Collectively as a family and individually as particular Christians. So here's the first thing, what you once were in verse 21. My family history is so far boring, no scandals, but our spiritual history, sadly, is not without scandal. Paul uses two phrases to describe what we once were. He says that we were alienated. And he says that we were enemies of God. Two uncomfortable words for us, and yet there they are in the Bible. We need to understand what they mean. Paul is saying, we have been alienated from God. Verse 21, once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior. Now, we know what it means to be alienated. It may not be a word that we find ourselves using much, but we do know what it means. And we know something of the experience of being alienated. It can happen on lots of different levels. It can happen, sadly, in our families. Sometimes there may be alienation. People who just don't get on, who don't see each other, who don't talk to each other, where there's a distance, a lack of understanding. Sadly, there can be alienation even within a marriage. Again, of feeling like we're not connecting. There's a rift, there's a distance. There can be alienation between friends. Maybe some of us have experienced that. There can be alienation within society. One of the things that we began to become more aware of last year with the Black Lives Matter movement is how a group of people can feel alienated from the wider structures of society, feeling as though things are never in their favor. But even at the personal level, with ourselves, we can experience alienation. We can feel out of sorts with ourselves. Everything from feeling like you're your own worst enemy to being uncomfortable in your own skin, even being uncomfortable in your own body. All of these things are a form of alienation. And we see those realities described for us many times in the Bible. We see them accounted for in the Bible. And we also see that the deeper alienation underneath all of those and at the root of all of them is alienation from God. This is what all of us naturally find ourselves being, left to our own devices. God becomes a stranger to us. This is the natural state of humankind, is to be alienated from God. I became a Christian 28 years ago this summer, in August, and I can still remember vividly that my sort of first brush with the Christian faith when I was just turning 18. That makes me 46, if you want to just save you spending the next 10 minutes trying to work that one out. But I remember going to a church youth ministry, hearing a talk on what Jesus came to do for us and who he is. And I suddenly thought that if God was real, if God really had made me, if God was there, if God was my creator, I had no idea who he was. And I suddenly thought, well, if God had made me, I'm probably supposed to know him. And yet I don't. And I began to think to myself, that's probably more likely to be on me than it is on God. But I had a sudden awareness I was alienated from him. If he was there, I didn't know him. I wasn't close to him. And we've been made to know him. We've been made to delight in God, made to know him intimately. Now, God has made us in such a way that we're designed to be people who are meant to think like him. We're meant to care for the things that God cares for. We're meant to love the things that God loves and to love in the way that God loves. And yet, actually, we don't do that, and we wouldn't know how to do that. We might have a guess here and there. We might have a few instincts, but actually, we don't naturally know what God is like. He's a stranger to us. So Paul says we're alienated from God, and then he says in verse 21 that we were enemies of God. It wasn't just that there was distance, but actually at least a part of why God was unknown to us was because we wanted to be oblivious to him. Now, Paul's language here is very uncomfortable. It may well be for many of us, perhaps even offensive, that Paul could say we were enemies of God. But it is something that we see repeatedly in the Bible. It's not Paul just got out of the wrong side of bed this particular day and had a slightly dim view of us. Listen to Romans 8, verse 7. This is what we read there. The sinful mind is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. And so in Romans, we're seeing that we don't live for God because we can't. And we can't live for God because we won't. The sinful mind is hostile to God, or Ephesians 4. We read these words talking about humanity in general. We read, they are darkened in their understanding and separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. So there's a gap between us and God because we're ignorant of God. And we read in Ephesians, we're ignorant of God because our hearts are hard towards God. We're not naturally inclined to him. We're actually resistant to him. So the sad reality is that left to our own devices as human beings, whether we're conscious of it or not, whether we feel it or not, there is a deep antagonism towards God in our hearts. We might like the idea of God at some level in theory. We do need there to be a moral authority in the universe. We do want ultimate justice to be done. We do want every wrong to be made right. But we don't want that in a way that actually impinges on us. So we're spiritual NIMBYs, if you're familiar with NIMBYs. Not in my backyard. So it stands for people who would say that they're in theory of having a new recycling plant or a new power station or a new waste treatment center, unless it's designed to be built somewhere near their house, in which case they're furiously against it. And we're like that with God. We want a God of justice and righteousness and all of those things. We just don't want him in our backyard. We don't want him interfering in our lives. And it may surprise us to think about it in this particular way, but one of the most common ways we keep God at arm's length is by being religious. It's very easy for us to think, well, if I go to church and kind of pay my dues, if I nod my head to God, you know, every Sunday, if I sing some hymns, if I help around the place here and there, if I do my bit, God will get all the way off my back during the rest of the week. That's his end of the bargain. Or we might think, well, if I come along, if I get involved, if I help, then actually God then owes me. And it's his job then to give me kind of a basically happy and healthy life. But the fact is, if God is who he says he is, he deserves everything in our lives. And trying to sort of keep God negotiated at bay from certain areas is an expression of our hostility to him. So whether we are religious or rebellious, all of us by nature are enemies of God in our minds. Paul says in the end of verse 21, it's because of our evil behavior. Our behavior is the driver of this. We just don't want God meddling. We don't want him interfering. So that is what we once were, alienated from God and even hostile towards him. But Paul wonderfully doesn't stop there, because the Christian message doesn't stop there. In verse 22, Paul then shows us what we now are. So we move from what we once were to what we now are. And it's beautiful, reassuring, uplifting, heartening to hear Paul say, but now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death. That alienation and hostility to God was our backstory. But it's not the present reality for those Paul is writing to, and it's not the present reality for Christian people today. Now he has reconciled you. And he's done that through the death of Christ, through Christ's physical body, through death. This is not symbolic language. This is very real, that the physical body of Jesus died for us. Christ had to have a physical body because for God to redeem us, he had to become one of us. He had to become human, and Jesus did live a physical life of perfect obedience. All that we were meant to be, Jesus was. We were meant to be the perfect image of God. And we're told in verse 15 that Jesus is the image of God. He was able to be the humanity we fail to be. And he lived a physical life in that physical body, perfectly following and loving God. And he did that for us. He really did die a physical death. All that should have been ours, he took on himself, and all that should have been his, we can now enjoy. So on the cross, Jesus himself was alienated so that we might be reconciled. All the consequences of our enmity against God, Jesus took on himself. And so Paul can say, therefore, we have been reconciled through Jesus' death. And again, just as with Jesus himself, that reconciliation is something that can so easily diminish in our minds. Reconciliation is not just that there's a kind of ceasefire between us and God. It's not just that there's a truce. It's not just that there's an end of hostilities, an absence of enmity, and nor is it simply pardon. I think for many years of my Christian life, I thought the gospel was simply about being pardoned. And it is wonderfully about being pardoned, but it's more than that. When someone is pardoned, the message is you can go now. You're okay to go. But when there's reconciliation, the message is you can come now. It's not just the absence of a problem, it's the presence of a relationship. And sometimes we think of the gospel only in terms of what we've been saved from and not in terms of what we've been saved into. And we have been reconciled now. So apparently one of the things you get to do if you're president of the United States, in case any of you are considering that as a career move, one of the perks is that you get to pardon people. It's entirely at your discretion. And so one of the things apparently that often happens, and we've seen this over the last several years, particularly towards the end of a president's presidency, they'll start kind of pardoning normally their old cronies and all the rest of it who've ended up in jail. It's just one of the perks you have of that particular office. But you can imagine some criminal in a jail, maybe someone even on death row, maybe someone who's done something really despicable, receiving the news of a pardon from the president. And, we would struggle to imagine what that would feel like in terms of the relief and the burden being lifted. But here's the thing, even if you are pardoned by the president himself, you don't get a key to the front door of the White House. You can't just sort of turn up and pop in for dinner. Pardon alone is not relationship. But what we have here is reconciliation, pardon for sin and an invitation to be friends with God. We've been reconciled. And notice the tense here, verse 22, but now he's reconciled you. This has happened. It really has taken place. It's not something we're still waiting to see what the outcome is. We have full reconciliation from Christ through his death on the cross, which means God is not still on the fence about you. Now, we spend most of our days, if we're honest, on the fence about ourselves. And it goes up and down depending on the day of the week. Yesterday, horrendous day. Today, I'm doing a bit better. And we often think, well, God's probably sort of on the fence a bit too. He's sort of made some commitment towards us, but he's probably still keeping us a little bit at arm's length to kind of finally figure out what to do with us. Paul says we have been reconciled. It's happened. Which means, as a friend of mine says, we're 2,000 years too late to mess this up. It's been done. Before we were born, Jesus died for our reconciliation. This is what we now are, reconciled with our Heavenly Father. Which means even when we do mess things up, when we do mess things up, we're messing things up as those who are already the children of God. And nothing will threaten that relationship. Well, Paul doesn't linger there, and so our final point is what we shall be, because Paul moves on at the end of verse 22. He says, he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation. So this is what we will be. This is the point of it all. This is why God has done this. Why God has saved us and reconciled us is ultimately because he wants to present us. That's where this is all moving towards. One day God is going to present us kind of to himself, but also to the whole universe. And that presentation is going to be as people who are holy in his sight, people who are without blemish and free from accusation. We're not there yet, are we? We're not people without blemish. We're not people who are free from accusation. There's all kinds of stuff I'm sure we could wheel out on each other, things that we know that we've done. We're not yet holy, but we will be. That is God's plan for us. That is our future. We know from other parts of the New Testament that we will be holy when we see Jesus face to face, when he returns. We will be like him. Weddings are actually an amazing illustration of this truth. The way we do weddings sort of traditionally is not by accident. It has come about through people who wanted to show the ways in which a human marriage reflects the reconciliation we have with God. And so when you go to a wedding, typically the groom is the one who's already there first, because that's trying to reflect the fact that Jesus has gone ahead of us to prepare a place for us. He's there getting everything ready for us. But as a pastor who gets to take weddings, my favorite moment is when the bride first arrives. And you see the door open and the bride comes through and the entire congregation just, you know, hurts their neck, turning around to see the bride enter the building. And it doesn't matter how well you know the bride, it doesn't matter how many times you've seen the bride, her appearance is not a surprise to you, you know what she looks like. But somehow on a wedding day, when everyone turns to see the bride, everyone's reaction is the same, which is, wow. And the great thing about being the person taking the wedding is you not only get the best view in the house in terms of seeing the bride come down the aisle, but you get to see how the groom's responding. And that's normally a combination of, she came, and whoa, I get to marry that. And again, the choreography is intentional there, because the arrival of the bride is a picture of how we will be presented in the age to come. It's hard for some of us to imagine this, but when we are presented before God in the age to come, the universe is going to go, wow. And Jesus is going to go, wow. Because we will be presented one day as holy in God's sight, without blemish and free from accusation. In other words, we will be like Jesus. And Paul says this is the ground for our hope. So he says in verse 23, if you continue in your faith, established and firm, and do not move from the hope held out in the gospel. That word, if, I'm told by people who know Greek better than I do, which is anyone who knows Greek at all, is not meant to suggest that things are kind of up in the air and it's still hanging in the balance, but it's meant to give the sense of this is indeed going to be the case. This will be the case as we continue in our faith, established and firm, and not moving from the hope. So what is going to keep us persevering as Christians is this hope, this future prospect of what God has got in store for us, what God is going to do for us. And as we see that future hope, we keep going. It gives us energy day by day to keep following Jesus. Let me close by saying that the first mountain I ever got to hike up was on a gap year. I was in Kenya with some friends. We were working in an orphanage for a few months, and then we had a bit of time just to travel around and see the place. And one of the places we went to see was a mountain in the Rift Valley called Mount Longonot, which is a dormant volcano. The word dormant there was particularly significant as we were planning this. And we hiked up one day. We went there as a day trip. And we got to the base of this volcano. We're in the middle of the Rift Valley in East Africa. It's hot, it's dusty, it's dry. So even before we'd started the kind of climb, we were tired. And as we kind of plodded our way up the side of this mountain, I'm not the fittest person on the planet, even in my earlier days. And it was hard work. One of my friends was a bit ahead, another friend of mine was a bit behind. And then lots of times I would stop ostensibly to look at the view, but really just because I really needed to catch my breath. So I'd sort of stop and look out and go, what's that over there? Whilst just trying to get a bit of a rest. And as I was pressing on, the friend who was ahead of me got to the top, to the rim of the volcano, and I could see him up there. It looked like a brutal final ascent to get to the very top. But I couldn't see what he was seeing, but I could see the look on his eyes as he gazed out at the crater and at the view beyond it. And he turned around and called down to me and said, Sam, you are going to love this. And so even though I was exhausted and thirsty and tired, all of a sudden I was filled with adrenaline and just, you know, didn't quite sprint up there, but got up there pretty quick. I was energized because I could see from him that this was going to be amazing. And indeed it was. And Paul is saying something similar. As we have this hope before us, it gives us our daily energy to keep following Jesus, because we know what we shall be. So let me pray for us. Father, we thank you for this amazing vision of Jesus, again, the one who is supreme in every way, the one who is honest with us about our natural state before him, our natural state when we don't yet know him, the very Jesus who came to this world as a human and died for us and rose again for us. And this Jesus that we will one day become like, holy in your sight, without blemish and free from accusation. Father, we pray that that prospect would give us daily joy and resolve to keep following, because we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let us pray. We begin by asking for forgiveness. Father, we are so sorry for the damage we have been doing to this beautiful world. We are truly sorry and need your forgiveness. Please help us to care for nature and the environment. Stir our hearts this afternoon in thanks and praise. Oh God, thank you for the beautiful country we live in. Thank you for the rain and all the wonderful trees and flowers. Thank you for giving us a safe and secure place to live. and for keeping us and sustaining us. Lord, we praise you for our lovely church family, the joy of family life and the love you shine upon us every day. Oh God, our God, we praise and thank you for our NHS, so sorely stretched at the moment. Please bless and keep all our medical staff and protect them from illness and injury. Comfort and bless all those in hospital today. Lord, your Holy Spirit is our comforter. We praise you for that. We ask blessings upon our church leaders and their families. God bless the Queen and the royal family. We thank you for the Queen's great wisdom and spiritual strength over so many years, setting a wonderful example to us all. Oh God, we pray for our Prime Minister and his family. Please bless and help him. Strengthen his Christian faith so that he makes the right decisions with the cabinet. Loving God, when we are not sure what to do or say, guide us in the ways of faith, hope, and love. Help us to make good choices so that we may all be seen as your children in the world. Because we ask it for Jesus' sake, amen. And so we say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins. We forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. The power and glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
So let us stand and join together in worshipping our amazing Saviour.
We stand as the music starts and just have a look at that verse 3. When we stand before that throne in heaven, complete in Jesus, he died our soul to save. Let's really praise him in response and to his word today. So we stand.
Once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behaviour. But now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight without blemish and free from accusation. We thank you, God, that you are not too great to notice us. You are too great not to notice us. And Lord, I pray that you will help us in the coming week not to let our view of Jesus shrink, rather expand our knowledge and our understanding and our love of you by the Holy Spirit. So as we end, let's pray a word of blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace today and always. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Just a couple of things as we end. We are closing the doors into the main street. So exit is via the hallway this way and out through the side entrance. But please do join us for refreshments out that way before you depart. Do introduce yourself if you are new. We'd love to get to know you. And just one final thing, Yaku and I will be up at the front if anybody would like any prayer for anything. But God bless you all in the coming week.